Penguin Random House presents Explaining Life Through Evolution by Prosanta Chakrabarty, read by Alexander Thomas. This book has various pictorial figures present in it. To view these figures, please refer to the supplemental PDF available with this audiobook. Dedicated to teachers, dedicated to teaching.
Hello, this is the author, Prosanta Chakrabarty, reading from the introduction to the Indian edition of Explaining Life Through Evolution. There is a beautiful Sanskrit word, Ayurveda, that translates in English to the science of life. Although generally relating to human health or homeopathic medicine, I'd like to see the shift of this usage of Ayurveda to its literal translation as perhaps an enlightened synonym of biology, elan vital, or perhaps of evolution. It is a term that makes me think of how words and phrases can have different meanings for different people, and how words too can evolve. Even the word evolution evolved in Charles Darwin's time from meaning something closer to development, in the sense of developing embryo, to its current definition, essentially the accumulation of heritable changes in organisms that can lead to the formation of new species from ancestral forms. Interestingly, Darwin and others instead used the now obsolete word transmutation, which then meant something closer to our current definition of evolution. Over time, the meanings of words can change, but previous usages remain part of their history, just like species can retain their historical features of their ancestors. Except in biology, modifications often lead to entirely new species. So perhaps if we change Ayurveda to Ayurvedology, we'd have a better fit with the evolution analogy. When Priyanka Goswami approached me about publishing with Penguin Random House India, I got a bit nervous about the thought of publishing for an Indian audience. Born and raised in North America, I know India as my ancestral homeland, the birthplace of my parents, grandparents, great-grandparents, and ancestors back to time immemorial. Yet I still view India through the lens of a stranger. I am part of the Indian diaspora, but perhaps the part that sometimes feels adrift, distant, and disconnected from the motherland. My name, my facial features, my skin tone, all divulge my Indian heritage to North Americans. But my accent, my mannerisms, my experiences are all American. I own that duality, but often fumble the consolidation. E.g., I eat samosas with a fork and barbecue sauce. Throughout this Indian edition, you will see a bit of both sides of me. But hopefully my scientific perspectives will translate no matter what flavor of human you are. What does it even mean to be Indian in the biological sense? Well, read on. We will get to that. And if you are not Indian, no worries. This is a book about evolution and life, and you don't need to be an Ayurvedologist to understand it.
Part 1. A Personal Prologue. Called to Action. In 2008, the year I moved to the state, the Louisiana Science Education Act was passed with the backing of the then-governor, Bobby Jindal. The name of the law is misleading, as it allowed schools in Louisiana to teach the biblical account of creation in science classes as an alternative to evolution. Jindal went as far as to say that local schools should determine how science is taught in classrooms. That meant that if the local public school science teacher wanted to teach that all living land animals were the descendants of creatures carried on Noah's Ark, then, well, that was just fine with the governor and the supporters of the law. At the time, I presumed that Bobby Jindal, born Piyush Jindal, was probably a smart person who was somehow misled. I jokingly called him my Uncle Bobby, because as an Indian person, I could claim all other Indians as kin, and maybe saying the governor was a relative could get me out of a speeding ticket. It couldn't. My Uncle Bobby should have known better than to pass anti-evolution legislation. He was, after all, someone who held a biology degree from Brown University and a Rhodes Scholar. But going to an Ivy League school in Oxford doesn't necessarily make you smart, just educated. Part of the reason he promoted this law was to pander to the so-called religious right. At the very least, he knew that the law was illegal because of the separation of church and state, clauses of the First Amendment of the U.S. Constitution. He did know this, and he ignored it. So what's the big deal anyway? Well, you just don't teach your own religious views in a public science class. Science is about observing and testing natural phenomena in order to give a reasoned, evidence-based explanations for those events. Religion, on the other hand, can provide answers to questions science doesn't cover. Example, what is the meaning of life? But it can also provide answers that can't always be tested. For instance, let's say your answer to why apples drop to the ground when they fall out of a tree is, God made it happen. That isn't something I can prove false, because I can't test it. There isn't room for questioning things or scientific inquiry if you believe flatly that God controls everything that happens. The other problem with teaching religion in a science class is that there are many religions with a variety of beliefs. Faith-based beliefs about creation differ by your religious persuasion. In one version of the Hindu creation myth, the earth was part of the lotus flower that grew from the navel of Vishnu. And then the world was populated by Brahma and will be destroyed by Shiva. If I taught that version of creation as the truth in my science class, I wouldn't last very long as a teacher. However, maybe this religious take would do well in the so-called Indian Science Congress, especially among participants pushing fringe Hindutva ideas that take some religious ideas literally. Example, Brahma discovered dinosaurs. The problem again with the teaching God controls everything is that you can't prove or disprove it. In order to respond to a Noah's flood scenario, I say there is no boat that can fit a pair of all living land animals, and having just a pair of each species wouldn't provide enough genetic variability to restock the earth. Also, it can't rain for 40 days and 40 nights worldwide because we have a finite amount of water on Earth. And also, all the freshwater animals would go extinct as they would be inundated by salty marine water. And where did all that water go afterwards? And there is no evidence of a huge worldwide flood from a few thousand years ago. The reply is just always, God did it, so anything is possible. Well, I guess that would be the end of the conversation. God did it can be your go-to answer, and that is fine. I'm not here to judge or tell you how to live. My only issue is using that explanation to shut down scientific discourse in an academic setting. Science is all about testing explanations of natural phenomena to see if they hold up to rigorous testing. If you can explain everything away with God did it and controls everything, what's the point of the testing? What's the point of school? What's the point of curiosity? Religions ask for your faith in explaining the untestable and unprovable. Science is here to help explain the rest by making testable predictions. However, does science require some faith? Yes, I would say. You have to believe that the results and observations you make are based in reality and that the results are the outcomes of predictable phenomena. This idea dates back before Aristotle, but is explicit in the writings of religious philosophers such as Albertus Magnus, Thomas Aquinas, Roger Bacon, Avicenna, Averroes, and surely many others in every culture or religion or region. If a deity changed and influenced every scientific experiment on a whim, so that we couldn't make predictions and the laws of physics were not immutable, then, frankly, we wouldn't be able to explain our universe with any scientific investigations. However, that latter scenario isn't the case. We scientists can have faith in the fact that what we observe is an unmanipulated reality because our inquiries yield consistent and reliable results that allow us to reveal the secrets of our planet and of our universe ever more exactly. To paraphrase Galileo, religion shows the way to go to heaven, not the way the heavens go. Some would argue that there is room for studying nature in the slightly different religious take of God started everything and made the rules. That is, you can study the rules, example, gravity, evolution, and their consequences, without having to determine the origination of those rules. This playbook suits the non-overlapping magisteria. Stephen Jay Gould describes this in his book, Rocks of Ages. In that book, Gould argues that science and religion can complement each other without interfering with one another, as it does for many. I would perhaps state it more plainly as science should not be anti-religion, and religion should not be anti-science. There is certainly room for compromise and improved cultural competency on both sides. That anti-evolution law is still on the books in my state. I don't mean to pick on Louisiana. I genuinely love the state and am proud to call it my adopted home. My kids were born in Baton Rouge, and I've lived there for more than 10 years. Louisiana isn't the only state with issues over the teaching of evolution. In Alabama, biology textbooks include a disclaimer sticker warning you about the theory of evolution. In 2018, Arizona briefly had all the references to the word evolution deleted from the state's science education standards. It isn't just the so-called conservative states. I've met anti-evolution people in liberal Ann Arbor, where I obtained my PhD in evolutionary biology, and New York City, where I grew up. In fact, one in five high school teachers in the US teach creationism along with evolution in their classes. Many teach it as a preferred scientific alternative. It isn't just the US either. Only 26% of people in Afghanistan accept human evolution. And in 2017, Turkey removed references to evolution from its textbooks. Notably, the US ranks near Turkey, now called Turkey, in terms of how human evolution is accepted by the general public. Indians appear to be much more accepting of evolution and science, despite also being deeply religious. Unfortunately, in 2023, India cut the teaching of evolution from schools, and it will no longer be.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.